есть мачта 30-й.
Доклады принял первый. Пуск.
Есть пуск. Зажигание. Предварительное. Промежуточное. Главное. Подъем.
While most of the world is still caught up in the excitement and wonder of Apollo 11 and celebrating the return of Armstrong, Aldrin, and Collins, the National Aeronautics and Space Administration is rapidly moving ahead towards the second expedition to the lunar surface, to be launched on the cold, rainy morning of November 14th, 1969. Saturn V serial AS507 is rolled out to the pad. Mankind is ready to take steps on another world once again. Apollo 12, being the second mission to the lunar surface, is burdened with new challenges to be met by a crew that's been training for such a mission for well over a year. Alan Bean has never flown into space before. He's a former Navy test pilot turned astronaut who spent most of his career holed up in the underfunded offices of the agency's Skylab program, a study into the feasibility of an orbital space station that seemed decades away if it would ever happen at all. That was until the commander of Apollo 12, Pete Conrad, who happened to be Alan Bean's former flight instructor, barged in and offered him a seat on the second manned mission to the surface of the moon. Pete Conrad has flown into space twice before, once on Gemini 5 with Mercury astronaut Gordon Cooper, and again as commander on Gemini 11, where his flight partner was Richard Gordon, who will be flying with Pete again as the command module pilot of this mission, Apollo 12. The chemistry and camaraderie of Apollo 12's crew is unique among all Apollo missions. They are all Navy pilots. They have all known each other for years, and they are all good friends. 2.5 years earlier, an unmanned Atlas Centaur rocket launched Surveyor 3, the second ever successful unmanned American landing on the moon. Despite being long dead, Surveyor 3 just so happens to be located in the incredibly vast expanse of dried lava known as the Ocean of Storms, the largest lunar mare, located on the western face of the near side. Should Pete Conrad and Alan Bean manage to land within walking distance of Surveyor 3, a secondary objective will be to pay a visit to the unmanned spacecraft and retrieve portions of it for return to Earth. Apollo 12 is pushing the envelope of manned lunar exploration. Apart from attempting to make an exact pinpoint landing on the moon, Apollo 12 also plans to stay longer on the lunar surface. Apollo 11, the first lunar landing, spent 21.5 hours on the lunar surface, 2 hours and 40 minutes of that time outside the lander. Apollo 12 expects to beat that duration record by nearly 10 hours, and with this expanded window, perform not one, but 2 spacewalks, each lasting nearly twice as long, just under 4 hours. Spacewalk 1 will be dedicated to performing the flag ceremony, setting up new communications equipment such as a deployable long-range S-band antenna, and the construction of a battery of scientific instruments known as ALSEP.
You recall in Apollo 11, our primary objective, our objective, was to land and return men safely from the moon. Apollo 12 has somewhat different objectives, but an extension of this, shall I say. We do want to perform scenological inspection, survey and sampling in the Mara area. This is a different Mara area. On this mission, we will deploy the ALSEP, which is the Apollo Lunar Surface Experiment Package.
ALSEP, Apollo Lunar Surface Experiments Package. It was conceived long before the flight of Apollo 12. It consists of a central computer with an antenna on top, controlled from the Earth, connected to six or more experiments via wires, all powered by an RTG, or radioisotope thermoelectric generator. This ingenious device uses the natural heat given off by an unstable heavy element, in this case, plutonium-238, and converts it into electricity. While not quite nuclear fission, it does exploit the properties of atomic power and is not reliant on the sun or any special surface conditions to generate energy. As the fuel source decays over time, the amount of power the RTG generates dwindles. ALSEP-1 is planned to beam back information from six different instruments over the course of a calendar year, long after the astronauts leave. Its six experiments are the Lunar Passive Seismometer for measuring and relaying global meteoroid impacts and moonquakes, a magnetometer for measuring the magnetic field at the lunar surface and how it varies upon interaction with the sun, a solar wind device for monitoring the interaction of solar particles with the moon, a lunar ionosphere detector for measuring flux, energy, and the velocity of positive ions in the lunar ionosphere, a lunar atmosphere detector for measuring minute changes in the ambient lunar atmospheric density, and a lunar dust detector for measuring dust accumulation on the ALSEP over time. NASA is merely responsible for training its astronauts in the art of constructing the ALSEP, and ultimately delivering that ALSEP onto the surface of the moon. But once it is built, it will be operated by those who design the instruments, primarily universities, located all across the United States, from MIT to Rice. The ALSEP itself will be stored in the descent stage of the lunar module, in the aft left bay, an area specifically designed for the storage of scientific instrumentation. The command module of Apollo 12, CSM-108, is nicknamed Yankee Clipper. The lunar module, LEM number 6, is nicknamed Intrepid.
As you are all well aware, later missions will take us to spots that require a pinpoint accuracy. We do hope to develop our techniques on this mission that will lead us to perhaps further development on the next mission, leading us to getting a capability of landing at some very tight, difficult spots. We want to continue to develop man's capability to work in the lunar environment. And on this mission, one of our objectives is to obtain photographs of candidate exploration sites. On the Apollo 11 mission, ground control gave them a 60-second warning and a 30-second warning.
Now, it's my expectation that we're going to have something on our flight, two or three things, we've had them on every flight, where nobody's thought of it before. It's never happened before. We've never even considered it. It's going to come up. And the thing that makes us all feel good about this thing is we've got a team together here, both in flight and on the ground, that can solve these problems as they come up, no matter what phase they're in. So I don't think that the 1201, 1202 alarms are as... they're a bad situation, but I think the beauty of the whole thing is the fact that we were able to do it real time, solve the problem, make the landing. And I hope we don't have anything that bad, but if we do, I hope we can handle it as well as they did.
And the other thing is we're going to spend another 24 hours in lunar orbit, and I'm going to ask Dick to give you a rundown on the operations in lunar orbit that he intends to perform. We're trying to get efficient. Dick has some experiments to do while we're down on the lunar surface, and he'll give you a little rundown on that.
There are three areas of genuine interest as future landing sites. One of them is Lalande, and the other is Descartes, and the third being Fra Mauro. Now, these three areas will receive considerable attention as far as photography is concerned from our crew.
Set against a dark gray sky, the countdown for Apollo 12 enters the terminal phase on November 14th, 1969. As the clock approached 11:22 in the morning, a deck of low-altitude clouds began to cover the Kennedy Space Center and surrounding areas. A soft sheet of rain steadily poured onto the onlookers below, including President of the United States, Richard Nixon. Apollo 12 was ready to fly.
T-minus 5 minutes and counting. T-minus 5, that swing arm, number 9, will now be coming back to its fully retracted position at the pad. Mark, the swing arm now moving back from the spacecraft as planned at the 5 minute mark in the count. Just before coming up on the swing arm removal, we went through our final status checks and received a loud and strong go from the mission director, Chet Lee, launch operations manager, Paul Donnelly, and launch director, Walt Caprian, responding to the request from the test supervisor. T-minus 90 seconds and counting, T-minus 90, still go. Our status board here in firing room 2 indicates all is still well with the countdown. Third stage tanks now pressurized as the automatic sequence continues. 1 minute, 15 seconds and counting. Captain Alan Bean has just brought the entry batteries on the main power source in the spacecraft. We've conserved those batteries up to this time. We're coming up on 60 seconds. Mark, T-minus 60 seconds and counting, T-minus 60. Alan Bean running up the volume on his VHF. 50 seconds and counting. 50. We've now gone internal power with the launch vehicle. We're on the internal batteries in the three stages of the Saturn V. T-minus 40 seconds and counting. The spacecraft commander now performing his final function, pressing a button to align the guidance and control system of the spacecraft. Coming up on 30. Mark, T-minus 30 seconds and counting, T-minus 30. 25 seconds and counting, we're still proceeding. T-minus 20. 17 seconds, swing arm back. We have guidance in general. 10, 9, 8, ignition sequence start. 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. All engines running. Liftoff. We have to run at 11:22 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. Pete Conrad reports that your program is in.
Stand by. Seven engines. Go ahead and try to reset your fuel cell now.
So reset fuel cell. Wait for staging.
Yeah.
Hang on. 25. 27.
Inboard engine out on schedule.
32.
Your thrust is looking good, Pete.
Okay, I have a good GD through, and Al has got the fuel cells back on, and we'll be working on our AC buses.
Right, Pete, your fuel cells look good down here.
Think we need to do a little more all-weather testing.
Amen.
The only real constraint for a Saturn V launch was wind. Apollo 12 experienced little to none, but what the launch vehicle and her crew did experience is something no astronaut had ever trained for, a lightning strike. Apollo 12 was struck by lightning not once, but twice, both less than a minute into flight. At 36 and 52 seconds, lightning bolts struck the vehicle and rode the exhaust trail down to the pad. The effect was immediate. The command module guidance computer, the primary flight computer responsible for vehicle guidance and control, had been stunned. It immediately lost platform reference and suddenly had no idea which way the vehicle was pointed. In addition to the loss of the guidance computer, 9 temperature and pressure sensors in the service module were knocked offline, and all 3 fuel cells were automatically removed from the spacecraft buses. The entire rocket, for the time being, was powered only by the re-entry batteries. The second strike at 52 seconds knocked out the spacecraft's attitude indicator, the nav ball within the spacecraft, which began tumbling out of control. Fortunately, there was a backup guidance computer. The Saturn V IU, or instrument unit, had not been affected. It immediately took over primary vehicle control, and despite a momentary loss of telemetry, the rocket never drifted off course. The command module re-entry batteries are not designed to maintain 75 amp loads, which was the power requirement during launch. One of the AC inverters dropped offline, and these power supply problems lit nearly every warning light on the control panel simultaneously, causing further instrumentation to malfunction. Although the cool-headed crew of Apollo 12 never panicked, the real heroes of the day were the flight controllers at Houston. The controller responsible for electrical, environmental, and consumables during the launch of Apollo 12, known as ECOM, was John Aaron, who made the call SCE to AUX. Signal Condition Electronics, those being the internal instruments visible to the crew, were switched to an auxiliary or backup power supply. Alan Bean flipped the switch, and the 3-man crew was once again able to take control of the situation, avoiding what could have been a launch abort. Apollo 12 had come closer to the program's first in-flight failure than any mission had previously, but the adventure had only just started.
We had 11 electrical warning lights associated with the electrical panel, and in all our simulations and double failures and triple failures, they never figured out how to light all 11 of them at one time. But they were all on.
Later on, Al asked me, why didn't I help him?
I didn't help. He wasn't quite as polite as he did right now.
I didn't help Al because I didn't know what the hell to do.
We learned a lot that day on Apollo 12.
We became the longest lightning rod in history.
Hey, that's one of the better synths, believe me.
We've had a couple of cardiac arrests down here too, Pete.
There wasn't any time for that up here. Okay, we're all chuckling up here over the lights. We all said there were so many on we couldn't read them.
After spending 2.5 hours orbiting the Earth, frantically investigating every last spacecraft subsystem, it was determined that no permanent damage had been done due to the lightning strike. There was only one system that couldn't be tested, the pyros that triggered the spacecraft's parachutes. It wouldn't make a difference if Apollo 12 re-entered now or 9 days from now on their way back from the moon. If the parachutes were gone, it would mean certain death either way. So the decision was made to press on. One unfortunate side effect of a rainy launch that was permanent was the heavy contamination of all spacecraft windows. The dust and plume debris associated with launch tower jettison mixed with vaporizing rainwater, depositing heavy concentrations of dirt in the form of streaks on the windows of Apollo 12's CSM. A major annoyance to the crew, but not mission critical. Apollo 12 relit its third stage just under 3 hours after launch, and Pete Conrad, Alan Bean, Richard Gordon, three astronauts, three friends, were now drifting on their way, faster than a bullet, towards the moon.
Dick Gordon's moon to silk.
Hey, Jared, Dick, how much fuel did I waste during that docking?
Hang tight, Dick, we'll check. Houston, you were nominal. You used 70 pounds.
That's too much.
Okay, 12, now we can see the Earth is indeed round.
Hey, Jared, it's a fantastic sight. The Mississippi Valley has a little bit of cloud coverage coming down from Canada, and there's some in the northeast part of the country. Up in the New England states, looks like maybe get some snow here the next day or two. Florida is cut in half with that front that went through this morning. West Coast looks absolutely gorgeous. Baja California is clear. Looks like the San Diego, Los Angeles area to the south and west of them is a little cloud covered. I won't say anything about smog.
Roger, you see any more dry fronts anywhere?
Hey, that was one of the driest ones I've seen in a long time. I hope I never see another one like it.
Maneuver's initiated, Pete.
Okay, I can see it firing thrusters and I can see it start to yaw.
Well, Houston, give us Omni Delta, please. We're copying your TV real clear now, and the jerking has stopped. It's looking good.
How does the homeland look to you?
Beginning to look kind of small.
Really weird, Houston. There's something that's venting radially, and then there's something that's venting along the axial axis, and it's sort of taking turns. And right now, it reminds me of some guy standing back there with a water hose, just spraying in any old direction. It's just, it keeps venting, whatever it is, and it just keeps blowing away in different directions.
Roger, Pete.
I'm trying to get all this on film for you.
Good deal. Hey, Red Baron, where's your scarf?
Well, I tell you, I think I forgot it during that boost phase. We ought to talk to you about all that good happening. That's a terrible way to break Al Bean into spaceflight, I'll tell you. All Al Bean kept saying was, there's power on the buttons, there's power on the buttons. And every light the right-hand side was lit. I kept thinking, why is he saying that to me?
To understand the photographs taken from any Apollo flight, one must first understand the trajectory. The moon is a remote and hostile place. Its environmental challenges to human life are numerous, and many constraints had to be made in the concept of an Apollo mission in order to allow for humans to walk about on the lunar surface. First, the moon is tidally locked to the Earth. For a tidally locked body, the orbital period is the same length as the rotational period, and one day on the lunar surface is approximately 1 month on Earth, 27 days. That means that for any given point on the lunar surface, with the exception of the polar regions, 2 weeks of straight sunlight, making it nearly 280 degrees Fahrenheit at high noon. Permanently shadowed areas like craters, as well as the lunar night, can see temperatures reach as cold as minus 250 degrees Fahrenheit. This 500 degree temperature difference is beyond the ability of the Apollo A7L lunar spacesuit to compensate, and thus, there is only a specific, finite period of time that any Apollo mission can visit a certain landing site. Either in lunar morning, when the sun is low in the sky, heating the surface laterally, or in lunar evening. However, surface temperature wasn't the only constraint. All Apollo missions aimed for the leading edge of the moon, meaning that once they were inserted into lunar orbit, the Apollo spacecraft would orbit clockwise around the moon as the moon orbited counterclockwise around the Earth. This meant that every single lunar lander approached its site on the near side, moving from east to west. If it was lunar evening, the sun would be low in the western sky, shining straight into the eyes of the astronauts. This was unacceptable, and therefore meant that the sun always had to be in the east, low in the sky, during lunar morning. Since the sun angle is based on longitude, and all Apollo landing sites had to be on the near side, this meant that every single Apollo mission launched when the moon was in the waxing crescent phase, and landed on the surface when it was in the first quarter phase, give or take 7 days, depending on how far east or west the landing site was. This meant that every time humans flew to the moon, the lighting conditions regarding the Earth and the moon, while slightly different, were largely similar. The further west the landing site was on the moon, the less illuminated the Earth was on the outbound trip. Apollo 12's landing site was the westernmost ever visited by humans. Compare this image from Apollo 12 with an image taken from Apollo 17 at around the same time. Apollo 17's landing site was the easternmost ever visited. The sunlight always comes from the left. Using this information, one can determine if a picture was taken on the outbound or inbound leg of a lunar flight. During the translunar and trans-Earth coast periods, the Apollo spacecraft experiences roughly 75 hours of sunlight, with a 500-degree temperature difference between sunlight and shadow. This can be extremely stressful on environmental control systems. A shaded window that could be iced over exists at the same time that a sunlit window is too hot to touch. In order to negate the thermal effects from the sun, Apollo's spacecraft routinely entered what is known as PTC, passive thermal control, nicknamed barbecue mode, in which the LEM CSM stack was oriented with its long axis perpendicular to the sun, so that when the spacecraft was put into a slow rotation about that axis, heating and cooling would be relatively uniform. The PTC maneuver requires the spacecraft to be rotated around the longitudinal axis in a slow roll of 0.35 degrees per second. One complete roll of 360 degrees takes around 17 minutes. In most cases, this meant that from either the two side windows, both the Earth and the Moon would slowly float by at least three times in a given hour. It was the ultimate perspective of the Earth-Moon system, and it was a perspective that was constantly changing as the Earth kept getting smaller and the Moon kept getting larger. For the astronauts of Apollo 12, the coast out towards the Moon was one spent testing the lunar module systems, making television transmissions, and relaxing. 83 hours into the mission, Apollo 12 passes behind the far side of the moon and retrofires perfectly into lunar orbit. At 10:17 p.m. the next day, on November 18th, Conrad and Bean fired Intrepid's reaction control system thrusters and separated from Richard Gordon inside Yankee Clipper.
I got minus one and nothing, so forget it.
Intrepid Houston, looks good.
On the tube, Jerry.
Real good, Dick, real good.
Okay.
Okay, Dick, yaw on left, 60. Roger, go out and box. 10, 9, 8, we have all 8, 7, 6, 5, 4. I have it.
Better start.
3, 4, 5. Descent engine command override on.
Hey, throttle up to 26.
Yep.
Copy, throttle on.
Can't hardly hear you for some reason. Okay. Hit it by for throttle up, Houston.
See, it looks good.
Throttle up. I have an altitude light out and a velocity light out.
Roger.
Looking good, looking good. Partial pressure CO2 is as usual zero. Got a couple of good winners in these two spacecraft.
Okay, we're out of 35,000.
Roger,
beat a bit on that one.
Yeah, I'm getting a fair amount of RCS firing, more than I think I should. But how's the gimbal looking, you guys?
They're looking good, Pete.
According to this here computer, it's right on the money.
Better turn that sequence camera on in a moment.
Okay, standing by for throttle down.
Let's give it another upgrade.
Throttle down. 6+2, 3.
Roger. Intrepid Houston, monitor descent fuel 2.
Looks good.
Descent fuel 2, it's there.
Intrepid Houston, you're looking good at 8.
Spring loaded to go grab that surveyor.
Roger, you're out of 10,000 feet. Hook up your lanyard.
Okay. Hey, baby.
I'm not sure.
Coming through 7.
Look
at P-64.
P-64.
There it is! Son of a gun! Right down the middle of the road!
Outstanding. 42 degrees, Pete.
Hey, it's fired right from the center of the crater.
Hey, look out there.
I can't believe it.
Amazing.
Fantastic.
42 degrees, Pete.
It's
right in 42, we're past 3,500.
Coming down at about 99 feet a second. You're looking good.
Looks good out there, Dave. Looks good.
32 degrees. You're at 800 feet. 33 degrees. You're at 98 feet.
33
degrees.
600
feet.
Antenna's
okay.
Yeah, I gotta get over here.
330
right.
Feet. Coming down at 4.
Got 11%.
Got loads of gas.
300 feet coming down at 5.
Hey, right. Look at that crater right where it's supposed to be.
Hey, you're beautiful.
10%. 257 feet coming down at 5.
240 coming down at 5.
Hey, you're really maneuvering around.
Yeah.
Come on down, Pete.
Okay.
10% fuel. 200 feet coming down at 3. You need to come on down.
Okay.
190 feet. Come on down, 180 feet. 9%, you're looking good. Gonna get some dust before long. 130 feet, 124 feet, Pete. 120 feet coming down at 6. You got 9%. 8%, you're looking okay. 96 feet coming down at 6. Slow down the descent rate. 80 feet coming down at 4, you're looking good. 70 feet, looking real good. 63 feet, 60 feet coming down at 3. 50 feet coming down. Watch for the dust.
Yep.
46.
Low level.
42 feet coming down at 3. Coming down at 2, okay. Start the clock. 42 feet coming down at 2. 40 coming down at 2. Looking good. Watch for that. 31, 32, 30 feet. Coming down at 2 feet. You got plenty of gas. Plenty of gas, dude. Hang in there.
30 seconds.
18 feet coming down at 2. He's got it made. Come on in there. 24 feet. Contact light.
Roger. Copy contact.
Rock. Pro.
Yeah, pro.
Okay. Inform off.
Okay.
I'll cycle these valves. You got your finish command override off.
Yep.
Okie dokie. I'll cycle the main shutoff valve.
Okay.
Bus seat closed. We get both brakes closed, babe.
The brakes are closed.
Good landing. Pete, outstanding,
man.
After arm on, beautiful. Descent set, fire.
Hey.
Man, oh man, Houston, I'll tell you, I think we're in a place that's a lot dustier than Neil. It's a good thing we had a simulator, because that was an IFR landing.
Roger, Pete.
I went, hi, Al.
I
know it. Holy crap, man, it's beautiful out here. It sure is. It's something else.
Apollo 12 touched down at 1:55 a.m. Eastern Time on the moon's Ocean of Storms. With the LEM's limited visibility, Commander Conrad wasn't sure how close he was to the surveyor, and he wouldn't know until he was able to step outside. EVA 1 began at 6:35 a.m., November 19th, 1969.
Is that a pretty looking sight, that well?
You're coming into the picture now, Pete.
Okay. Okay, got the old camera running. Okay. Down to the pit.
Okay.
Man, that may have been a small one for Neil, but that's a long one for me. I'm gonna step off the pad, Mike. Off the moon, that's off the moon. Hey, that's deep. I don't sink in too far. Boy, they'll never believe it. Guess what I see sitting on the side of the crater.
The landing had been perfect. Apollo 12 was within walking distance of Surveyor 3. A quarter of a million miles from the Earth, a manned spacecraft had been placed within mere yards of another ship launched 2.5 years earlier. It showed just how far the manned spaceflight program had come in 8 meager years. Bean joined Conrad at 7:14 in the morning, and the pair collected a 3-pound contingency sample of lunar material. They also deployed the S-band antenna and the solar wind experiment, a continuation from the one planted on Apollo 11, and of course, the American flag.
If you turn around and walk over to your right a little bit, look over that crater, you're going to see our pal sitting there. That's one steep slope it's on. Okay, now what have you got all over your boot, son? Picked up a piece of land in here. Situation. Okay. Here we go. Metaphor. Okay, I'm going in. So you got to watch it. Shut it. Yep. Can't see what you're doing. Come over here where I am. See that surveyor sitting there? There that thing is. Look at them. See, look how close we almost landed. That creeper. Beautiful, Pete. Look at the defense. It didn't even see the hole.
Apollo 12's flagpole was broken at the crossbar. It is the only one of the 6 flags planted that hangs limp. Unfortunately, the flag wasn't the only thing broken by the astronauts. When setting up the color TV camera, an upgrade from the slow scan black and white one used by 11, Alan Bean inadvertently pointed it at the shiny, reflective foil situated on Intrepid's descent stage. The bright, reflected sunlight had burnt out the tubes. Apollo 12's hopes of broadcasting its lunar surface activity, allowing millions of people and posterity to once again join 2 astronauts on the surface of the moon, had vanished. It may have been a good thing, however, that there wasn't a working television camera on the moon that day in 1969. As Conrad and Bean were flipping through their cuff checklists, they ran into an unexpected surprise.
Part of the evolution of working on the moon was how does the crew, once they're outside, follow the steps they have to take without memorizing every step? And somebody came up with the idea of a cuff checklist.
Okay. That looks good.
And the most convenient place for it to be located was right here on the wrist, because our watch was up here, then the checklist was here. It was a 2-page thing where I could flip pages. For example, it might say at 1 hour and 10 minutes, take photograph of surveyor and then dig a ditch or something. So I'd, at 1 hour and 10 minutes, I'd think, uh-oh, I better get over to surveyor and do this, or if I'm already there, I dig the ditch. And this was real good. So we're working on the moon. We'd been developing these checklists and using them in our training all along.
Part of the job of a backup crew in those days was to keep a little levity, keep things light, you know, try to back off on the tension a little bit.
So we're working with them and on the moon, we're working along, and all of a sudden I flip the page and I look down and here's this Playboy bunny. And I think, where did that come from? Because we were from, you know, I knew every page by then, by heart, and all of a sudden this was in here. And then on these pages, I thought, well, it says, and then one of the jobs I had to do was observe some mounds and stuff. And so here was this girl, and it says, observe the protuberances. They tried to use geological terms and stuff on this, but it's real cute. So I looked on a few other pages, and sure enough, there was a few more in there. So I ran over to where Pete was. I didn't say anything on the air, and pointed to mine, and he pointed to his, and we laughed with each other, but we didn't say a word because we knew there was going to be some little old ladies back on Earth that would be very upset that their tax dollars had sent Playboy bunnies up to the moon. I was running across the moon one time, and you know, you're wondering about, did the little old ladies, literally, that sewed this suit do a good job? Did they get every seam right? Did the glue work? You don't know. You know, you hope they did. And I was running along, and all of a sudden my ears popped, and I thought, is my suit leaking? That some pressure change in my suit. Wasn't supposed to do that. But what they found out later was, as I ran along, my suit was moving around as I ran, and the exhaust valve on my suit had bumped up against my belly, and it had stopped it up. And so what had happened was the pressure had gone up in the suit because it wasn't going out. It was just coming in. So NASA, being a wise organization, before the next flight, they put kind of like a basket over there so the air could go through, but nobody's stomach could close it up because it gave me a heck of a scare.
Yankee Clipper, Houston.
Houston Clipper here.
Dix, the EVA is going pretty well. They're 2.5 hours into it, and they've got the LSEP good way deployed. Apparently both of them look as though they just crawled out of a coal bin. Other than that, things pretty much nominal.
Very good, thank you.
Pete Nail, Houston, we show your 3+35 into the EVA. And you've got plenty of consumables, so we suggest you go at a relaxed hustle to get back in.
Oh, okay. It's almost all done. It's regretted me. Hey, yeah? I've got to dump some of this dirt. Come here. I feel like the guy in the shopping center waiting for his wife. Okay, I'm standing here holding two bags, buddy. Come in. Why is it your bed? Don't do anything with the LEC. Okay, what I want you to do, don't. Dump some dirt in this bag. Dump some dirt in that bag.
After 3 hours and 56 minutes, Conrad and Bean went back inside. They had successfully constructed the ALSEP and gathered 34.5 pounds of lunar samples, less than the amount collected by 11. But unlike 11, the astronauts were going to go outside once again. Conrad and Bean settled down and attempted to get some sleep on the moon using the new lunar module sleeping hammocks. The standard noises associated with the pressurized cabin of the LEM, as well as the circumstance of being on the surface of the moon, precluded any serious rest. And both astronauts mostly just lied awake, resting within their tiny craft on another world. 12.5 hours later, Conrad and Bean went outside again. This was to be their geologic traverse, dedicated to exploring the landing site and visiting Surveyor 3. First, the astronauts would split up. Conrad headed right, back towards the ALSEP, to check on it and ensure everything was still functioning properly. Bean headed out and left, towards a series of mounds and the rim of a crater called Head. It was later determined that these mounds were composed of slightly hardened clods of fine grain material that was ejected from the impact of Head or other nearby craters. Apart from simple rake and scoop samples, the astronauts also took core tube samples, penetrating as much as 70 centimeters into the lunar surface. No change in the texture or consistency of the lunar material was observed with depth. As encountered on Apollo 11, the subsurface material was darker than that at the surface, except in the area just northwest of Head Crater, where the subsurface material was lighter. Conrad and Bean joined together once again at Head Crater, and the pair continued moving south, sampling the rim of a smaller and sharper crater called Bench, and moving further still to a crater called Sharp. From there, the pair began their longest walking stretch, nearly 1,500 feet to the east, directly towards Surveyor 3, which is situated on the eastern side of the largest and shallowest crater in the immediate landing site, named after the Surveyor itself. Nearly 230 feet away from their seismometer, Conrad and Bean's footsteps still registered at Mission Control as the pair approached the Surveyor.
Well, it's kind of a, well, we'll get down there and get close inspection. What was the general color of all the structures? For example, all the struts and the like.
That's all white. The equipment bays and the primary structure was all painted with a white paint.
30 turn 10 or so. We'll have to look at it more closely. No, that's not happened. It changed color, huh? Sure has. Is that cut that paint brown? Oh, look at those pad marks. They're still there. Still waffle imprints on it. Okay, what's next? Toto TV sector. F8-15. Three pictures. Okay, let me move down. Hey, we got a nice brown Surveyor here. You see it? Even the tanks, which were raised the visor, it's not so brown, but it's painted. The glass is still on the top. Not a bit of it is fractured. Yep.
Here, right. Well, first of all, we show you're 3 hours into the EVA, and you're about 10 minutes behind the nominal traverse we have figured out for our 4-hour EVA. However, your first consumables are holding out real well, so we suggest you go on with the nominal traverse. We may want you to cut down to perhaps just one sample at Blocky Crater.
Okay, we recommend that you pack up where you are and start trying to pack up excess rocks you just got and think about ingress.
Okay, very good. Houston, I'd like to comment to all the people who are involved in this EVA, my congratulations.
Well, I think you two folks did an excellent job.
They removed the 17-pound TV camera, pieces of TV cable, the motorized scoop, alongside aluminum tubing and glass. It was around this point that the pair had to suppress a mild but building frustration. Alan Bean had brought along a timer that would shutter the Hasselblad camera and take an automatic picture, but he had misplaced it. A missed opportunity for Apollo's only picture of both astronauts on the lunar surface. Despite the fact that they had shattered the existing record for lunar surface activity, Bean and Conrad were not exhausted and had expended about 10% less energy than anticipated. By the time they returned to the lunar module, almost 40% of their oxygen supply was still remaining. However, for considerations of time and wanting to make ascent, they had to go back inside after 3 hours and 49 minutes. The third and fourth humans to walk on the moon had made it to a spectacular finish. Over 75 pounds of lunar samples, compared with Apollo 11's 48, were stowed safely back inside Intrepid and ready to be hauled to the Earth. After the mission, it would be discovered that the common bacterium Streptococcus mitis was alive on the Surveyor 3 camera and apparently had survived since the launch more than 2 years earlier. This was attributed by NASA to the camera not being sterilized on Earth before its launch, in a time before clean rooms and heavy garments. This unbelievable fact remains disputed, as it's also possible that the camera was contaminated during the return flight. The result remains controversial. Precisely 31 hours and 31 minutes after touchdown, Apollo 12's Intrepid ascended from the lunar surface, a mere 6 hours after the second EVA had ended. 90 minutes later, Conrad once again had Yankee Clipper in sight.
Thank you.
Conrad and Bean's spacesuits, after nearly 10 hours of walking around on the moon, were now completely covered in lunar dust. In order to prevent a large cloud of dust from contaminating the interior of the command module, the pair floated into Yankee Clipper wearing nothing but their underwear. Some accounts even claim they entered into their mothership naked. 2.5 hours later, the trio of astronauts, once again reunited, had fully stowed all the lunar samples safely into the command module and finally depressurized the docking tunnel. Intrepid separated from Yankee Clipper a second time at 147 hours, 59 minutes, and 31 seconds after the launch. Intrepid was remotely deorbited by mission control, purposefully retrofiring to impact the moon and create the first ever artificial moonquake that was to be recorded by the ALSEP. Using the seismometer, scientists on Earth were able to observe the moon reverberating like a bell for the better part of an hour. The impact was calculated to have released the equivalent energy of 1 ton of TNT. For the next 24 hours, Apollo 12 continued orbiting the moon. It did not depart lunar orbit immediately like Apollo 11. After a service module SPS engine burn changing the orbital inclination, Richard Gordon, Pete Conrad, and Alan Bean surveyed possible future landing sites from 70 miles up. Descartes, Framora, Lalande Crater. Now that Apollo had proven mankind's capability to make a pinpoint landing, future landing sites would be chosen for their geologic and scientific potential. Apollo 12, even after the surface phase, would continue adding to our burgeoning knowledge of the moon.
One of the things that you probably noticed on your TV screen is how rough it looks along the terminator line. And this was our impression the first time we passed over it. We said to ourselves, there's a real rough part of the moon. And the next day when the terminator moved 14 degrees, we found that the part that was now in a higher sun looked fairly smooth, or at least like the rest of the moon as you see it. And the part that was now under the terminator looked like the roughest. So I guess you get a real feel for the texture of the moon by looking at near the terminator, where you can see the height of the craters and the mountains and all the many features that are on the moon in more relief.
Roger.
If you point the camera up there towards the north, you can show them a couple of long rills.
172 hours after getting struck by lightning, Apollo 12 disappeared behind the leading edge of the moon a final time, and made the fateful trans-Earth injection burn that would place the lone spacecraft back onto a re-entry trajectory.
We've enjoyed the trip. Everybody adapted to zero-G real well. We enjoyed whistling in and out of the limb, and after having flown 8 days in Gemini, it's a real pleasure riding around in this thing, being able to move around and have all the good food, hot water, and shade, and all those good things we couldn't do. We kept the ship pretty spick and span, and we do have things all neatly stowed. I don't know if you can show up there. Why don't you show up the surveyor back? Oh, okay. Can't see it. Well, with that, I think we'll sign off, and we'll see you in about 3 days.
The questions that you'll be asked in this news conference have been submitted by newsmen here at the Manned Spacecraft Center who've been covering the flight. Some of the questions they raised will have been answered in your communications with Mission Control, but the public at large has not heard them. The questions are being read to you exactly as submitted by the newsmen and in an order of priority specified by them. Okay, here comes question number two. Was there some confusion about something you said yesterday about the launch into the thundercloud? Would you or would you not consent to launching under those conditions again?
I told you. We made it this time. Why can't we do it again?
Good, sir.
Okay, troops.
On its final day in space, Apollo 12 passed behind the Earth and witnessed a sight that has come to be known as the Diamond Ring.
Pete, while you're making preparations, the family's here on the Moker viewing you.
Good.
We got you on the big, big screen.
Hey, great. Tell them we'll be home in about a week.
Roger.
We wrote a little inscription over the FDAI and signed it.
Roger, try focusing in just a little bit. We can almost read it. It says, Yankee Clipper with Intrepid in tow.
No, it says, Yankee Clipper sailed with Intrepid to the Sea of Storms, Moon, November 14, 1969.
Roger, we can read it now. Thanks. And we copy the signatures.
And that's it, Jerry, for Apollo 12. Good night. We'll be talking to you tomorrow morning.
Roger, we'll be seeing you.
Early in the morning on November 24th, 10 days after launch, 244 hours and 22 minutes into the flight of Apollo 12, Yankee Clipper slammed into the upper echelons of Earth's atmosphere at 24,000 miles an hour, splashing down 375 miles east of American Samoa in the Pacific Ocean.
Hang on to your head as an order, Coach
King. Okay.
Keep us at how many G's?
1.5.
Half, that'd be my guess.
Here we go.
One.
Man, we're sick of
the water. I'm getting the water all
over. One.
Okay. God, that's fantastic.
Two.
Three. Man, am I getting the water.
Four. Five.
Getting something wet.
Five and a half.
Okay.
Six. Stand by for logic.
Standing by for logic and auto.
Okay, we're coming straight down. One G.
Okay, what else?
We're at
The splashdown was rough. The capsule had belly flopped onto a rising wave, hard enough to dislodge the 16mm camera that filmed this very sequence, which came falling down onto Alan Bean's forehead, concussing him and knocking him briefly unconscious, an injury that would require 6 stitches. That injury hurt, but it could be forgotten. What could not be forgotten were the trials and tribulations that faced a determined crew. With the help and quick decision-making of those consummate professionals working the consoles that day in Mission Control, these men tipped the balance in favor of Apollo 12 and allowed NASA to overcome what could have been the most public failure since the Apollo 1 fire. NASA had dodged a bullet and hoped for the sake of the program that nothing dangerous or unexpected would face the crew of Apollo 13, training for a mission to the Frau Moro Heights in the coming spring.
Each experiment representing a milestone in our knowledge of the moon.
The lunar atmosphere area inside has been turned on, and I'm very happy to say it's functioning perfectly.
The solar spectrometer has been functioning perfectly since the alpha has been turned on.
The seismic experiment, as it has been recorded, is functioning in all respects properly. We're going to have to throw the book away and begin over again. It seems to be the case for the moon in general.
Apollo 12 was a milestone in manned extraterrestrial exploration. It achieved its pinpoint landing as close as possible to its selected target marked by surveyors. It set a pace and a pattern of scientific exploration that future missions will not only follow, but will go beyond.